at age zero, I didn't really know what was going on. But I was born in southern Rhodesia, as it was then, Zimbabwe today, and Kariba was part of our national site. We had the biggest dam in the world, the biggest lake in the world. And so we grew up going to school and watching videos of some of the construction, but also the particularly the animal rescue that occurred afterwards. And I got a video through a mob called Memories of Rhodesia. And when we were talking about planning an event for EA CBD and for interest, I said, well, we'll just bung the DVD on. And then I thought, well, I'd better do a bit of research and find out a little bit about it so we can talk about it first. And I've gone on a voyage of discovery, and I found out all sorts of technical facts. So tonight we're going to have about half an hour of technical and other stuff, which will be me talking and stuff on the overhead, and then about 45 minutes of a collection of news articles and documentaries that have been put together. So here we go. I've probably already said all of that, so we'll go straight to the next one. Okay, where is Kariba? Kariba Dam is on the Zambezi River, on the border between what's today Zimbabwe and Zambia. The Zambezi River is 2,500 kilometres long and has a very big catchment area, 1.3 million kilometres squared. The catchment of Kariba is 663,000 kilometres. Lake Kariba itself is 200 kilometres long, up to 40 kilometres wide, and has a surface area of 5,400 square kilometres. And the name Kariba is interesting, and Jeff, where's Jeff? You're from Harare?
Yes.
You're Shona?
Yes, yes.
So the word Kariba, or Kariba, is a trap in the Shona language?
Yeah.
And apparently, when they were explaining to the native people who lived along the shores that they were going to dam the river, they explained that it was going to be trapped, and they used the word riva, kariba. And that, because of the difficult pronunciations, the different pronunciations of the dialects, became kariba. Bet you didn't know that. Okay, when I set this up on my computer, I've got a later version of PowerPoint, and it brings up a little red dot when you press Control. So I'll just have to use it, but it doesn't on this one. So I'll just have to, and it is nice and red there. You can see the Zambezi River. It starts, shoots down, and it joins the Zimbabwean border just before Victoria Falls. Keeps flowing along the border. This is Lake Kariba itself, then flows up, continue on the border, and then into Mozambique, through what is today Lake Corobasa. That was built later on in the 70s, and from there, where's my pointer gone? Down into the Indian Ocean on the east coast in Mozambique. So you can see it's a very long and large river. The other thing I want to point out, if I can get there, is the Kafue River and the Kafue Gorge Reservoir, because that played a part in the history of where the decision was made to build the dam. So that's a bit of a close-up of Kariba itself. The southern part today has numerous game reserves. The northern part is not game reserve, it's habited, and there are mainly sort of habitation. So the history, it was proposed and implemented by the government of the Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland, which was a federation that lasted for about 6 years, and today those countries are Zimbabwe, Zambia and Malawi. There was a planning period of about 6 or 7 years, from 46 to 53. Two dam sites received serious consideration, the Kariba site and Kafue. So I mentioned Kafue and where it was further downstream. The sole purpose of the dam when it was under consideration was for hydroelectricity, and that was to provide the northern Rhodesian copper belt and the industrial centres of southern Rhodesia. Previous studies had looked at irrigation potential, a bridge and a smaller hydroelectric scheme. And after initially deciding in 1953 that they were going to dam the Kafue, the newly formed federation changed the decision to the Kariba site because that benefited more members of the federation. Hydrology, a very important part of building a dam, how much water is going to come down. Well, they maintained river level records at Victoria Falls, which is quite some distance upstream since 1924. Shirundu, which is downstream, or 40 miles downstream since 1937, and the Kariba Gorge itself since 1948. The chief hydrologist of Northern Rhodesia at the time was Mr. Jim Scott, and I got in contact with him through Kate Condon, who is in EA. And he's a sprightly 92 and living in Brisbane, and it was quite amazing to have a little chat to him about Kariba and his time there. So he advised that three additional gauging stations were constructed and connected via telemetry to the Kariba Control Centre. So that's used for flood monitoring and to calculate how much water is coming down, whether it opened the floodgates or not. And he also told me that he erected a seiche meter. Now, a seiche is a standing wave in a lake. So it can be created by a wind or normally by wind, so if there's a prevailing wind, it'll push all the water to one end of the lake and it'll bounce back, and as it bounces back, the waves interact, and if you remember your interacting wave thingo, you can get higher peaks, lower troughs, and then but they're stationary. So whether there is much seiche activity, I didn't manage to find out, but I found it interesting that they did want to measure it. So the actual site, 5 or 6 years of investigations before the most suitable site was selected, about 2 miles downstream from the upper end of the 16-mile gorge. So the topography upstream of Kariba is very flat. As you'll see, when the maximum water depth is 97 metres, but the lake is 280 kilometres long. So that gives you an idea that over 280 kilometres, the river profile only changes by 97 metres. And that's why the lake is so long, because the terrain upstream is so flat. So the site that was selected, as I said, two miles downstream from the gorge, at bed level there was sound bedrock, and at that location the low flow river was confined to a narrow channel close to the right bank, which simplified diversion works. All of the sites downstream had a thick layer of riverine deposits, which would have made it very difficult and more costly for little gain in the power head. I found a wonderful paper on the internet, which was written by three of the people very closely involved, and found out all sorts of information from that engineering paper. The civil engineering work and coordination design consultants was a consortium of Gibcoin Sogay, consortium of a British firm of Sir Alexander Gibb and Partners, which is a very large and well-known firm. Two French firms, Coin et Bellier, and Société Générale d'Exploitation Industrielle, much easier to say, Sogay. So the dam was designed by French engineer and inventor André Coin, and he was a specialist in arch dams, and he personally designed over 70 dams in 14 countries. So Kariba is a double arch dam, and we'll go into that in a bit more detail. Mechanical, electrical and transmission was Mertz and McClellan, London and Newcastle, and there were six other local associated consultant engineers and architects. So many different types of dam were considered. There were 16 different shapes studied and tested. Plaster models about 1 in 400 scale were tested with hydraulic jacks, some to destruction. So that equates to about 300 or 400 high. And Kariba
is about 1 to 5 height to length ratio, so that's probably about 1.5 wide. That was the size of the model. So with the testing, they calculated that Kariba has a factor of safety of at least 4. The model tests were also checked by calculation on a trial load basis, trial load analysis. And as I said, it's a double curvature arch dam. So what that means is there is a vertical curve as well as a horizontal curve. That's the double curve with a 1 to 5 height to length ratio. The other good thing about the dam site was that the width of the dam foundations at river level were reduced to a minimum because of the width of the channel. The height of the dam is 128 metres high, it's 579 metres long. The thickness varies from 24 to 14 metres, and it can withstand a thrust of 2.5 million tonnes. So there's a cross-section in the centre of the dam at the spillway, and the vertical curvature there is, as you can see, not very pronounced. The top of the dam overhangs the spillway slightly, so you can actually stand on the curb of the dam and you can look straight down to the bottom. It's rather scary. You can see a few galleries. Okay, those run the full length of the dam, to my knowledge, and therefore monitoring purposes, every 5 years there is a major safety analysis done on the dam. When I was in the army, I was stationed in Kariba for about 6 months, and one night I was detailed to go and look after some people in the control centre. So they knew it was going to be a quiet night, and they said, go and explore. So I had a wander around the machine hall, and I started walking down one of these galleries. And nothing creaked or groaned, but I was very aware that that some people had lost their lives during the construction of the dam, and I said, I didn't go too far down that tunnel. So that's a plan of the dam. You can see that the horizontal curvature is very marked. It's almost a semicircle. You can see in the flanks the vertical curve. The footing sits in front of the crest, whereas at the spillway area in the centre, it is more vertical. And I guess that was the ultimate shape that was selected by COIN and with all the testing to withstand the big forces. All right, the tendering process was commenced in August 1955, and tenders were called for the construction of the wall and the power station. 74 concerns tendered, and contracts were awarded 23 civil contracts, 47 mechanical and electrical. And interestingly, they applied bonuses for milestone achievements, and the bonuses paid out total about 4% of the total value. And in the paper, the consultants reckoned that was very, very good value for money. Principal contractors. The Civil Engineering and Building Works was awarded to an Italian consortium called Impressit. They are still trading today as Impreglio. The water turbines went to Roving and Company Generators, Metropolitan Vickers Electrical Export Company, and the 330 kV transformers went to Ferranti and English Electric. So that's a more general view of the dam site. Some interesting points to note that, let's go back, okay, on the northern bank, the quarry stockpiles, sand stockpiles, cement and the batching plant were set up. That's the wall itself, obviously. The underground power station sits there, with its tail races heading out that way. There's a switching station up here. And for construction, they set up a Blondin cable crane. So
along that sort of circular thing is a rail track, and the Blondin carriages sat on this rail track, anchored across to this point here. So you can see that that sort of triangle was the area of influence of the Blondin carriages, and these could be guided across and concrete or materials in various parts of the dam. All right, the construction of the concrete dam itself took 2 years and 7 months and was completed 6 months ahead of schedule. The spillway has 6 submerged caterpillar type gates, each 8.8 by 9 metres. And if they're running full throttle, they can spill 9,500 cubic metres a second. And I checked out a couple of stats there, and that would fill Dumbleton Weir, which is our main water supply. If it was empty, it would fill it in 15 minutes at that rate. So that's not the full flow of the river, because it can flow, it can peak much, much higher than that, but that's the capacity of the floodgates. Now, the original design had 4 gates, but this was increased to 6 after the 58 flood, and you'll see in the construction, which we'll go to a little bit, how that affected things, but it was a major flood that occurred, and it was probably very lucky that it occurred, because it enabled the design to be modified on the run. They only open all 6 gates occasionally when there's big floods upstream. The last time that I'm aware of was 2010. And the profile of the sluices, if you go back to your cross-section, if you remember how the water was thrown out, it's designed to throw the jet 100 metres downstream to disperse the energy and reduce scour. And the dam has also been designed to completely overtop without damage to the foundations. And I don't believe it ever has. I think it has been kept within its design parameters in terms of fullness. So the construction, there were 3 main stages of the dam itself. In the low flow seasons of 55-56, they constructed a semicircular cofferdam on the left bank about 18 metres above foundations and 180 metres diameter. Sort of start getting a picture of the vastness of this thing. And during the flood season of December 56 to June 57, within that cofferdam they were going to construct, dam foundations, including full temporary openings within that cofferdam. They also constructed a diversion tunnel of 100 square metre diameter. That's not right. 100 square metre area on the right bank. They also excavated the channel upstream and downstream of the temporary openings, and they constructed a road and footbridge down, two different bridges, road bridge and footbridge separately downstream of the dam. So, this is the first cofferdam, stage one cofferdam. Within that, they built part of the footings and 4 temporary openings through the footings. They excavated this channel. They built the road bridge, and the footbridge was down here. And they built the diversion tunnel. That is the main cofferdam. Part of that, as much could be built on the sandy banks, was also built during that stage. So there's a picture of the cofferdam, the first cofferdam before any foundations are built, and the footbridge. So that's taken from the south bank looking north. The stage two construction was to bypass the river through the 4 temporary openings in mid-1957. Reduce the water flow in the main channel by tipping a rock-filled cofferdam from the bridge. So that was an interesting exercise in itself, tipping enough rocky material to stem the flow. And then upstream of that, build a sheet pile structure to form the base of the main cofferdam. Then the main river channel would be closed with a circular cofferdam, 112 metre diameter and 44 metres high. 44 metres high is pretty high for a cofferdam, I think. So again, you get the idea of the size of this thing. Deorder and construct the dam foundations during flood season, December 57 to June 58. So the cofferdam was designed to
for a 1 in 4 flood, well, a 1 in 4 event. And as we'll see, that was not quite enough. So this is the road bridge here, and that's the rock fill they tipped to stem the flow after they had opened up the diversion channel. And then they built the cofferdam to start constructing the balance of the footings. Stage 3 construction was to close the river and commence impounding by blocking 4 temporary openings and blocking the diversion tunnel at the end of the low flow season in November-December 58. So it was vital that the various stages were carried out at the specified time to avoid the delay of a season and considerable loss of power earnings. So each season was carefully planned in terms of the low flow and high flow to try and get all the construction completed. So that's the third phase, where the main cofferdam is complete and the balance of the footings can be constructed. Once they were up to a certain height above any sort of flood level, then obviously they could just keep going. So they experienced 3 major difficulties during construction. The very first was a flood in 1957, which overtopped the first cofferdam, the left bank cofferdam. It was designed for a 1 in 4 year event of 7,650 cubic metres per second, and it was overtopped by a flood of 8,500 cubic metres per second. Estimated to be a 1 in 100 year event. 5 weeks' time was lost, but little damage to the main structure, and the river was ultimately diverted on schedule. Second major construction difficulty was the sheet piling for the main cofferdam. So that was constructed in 6 metre square cells. So the sheet piles were driven down. The top of the cells was filled with no fines aggregate and sand cement grout injected into that top layer. So that formed a stable platform. They then drilled through that, because underneath was sand and rock. They pumped the sand out, and then they left the rocks in there, and then they filled up the voids with grout. So the biggest problem there was that the large depth of holes, up to 12 metres, prevented the sheet piles from actually hitting the bedrock at the bottom. So they couldn't actually seal the bottom of these cells. And as they pumped out the sand, more sand came in from the side. Ultimately, they did achieve the goal. And the second cofferdam was actually raised from its previous design, and it was designed to cater for a flood of 8,500 cubic metres, which was the flood they'd had the year before. Bear in mind, they'd only had records for about 25 years, so it's a bit difficult to really assess, as you can understand from statistics, what they may or may not expect. So the third and greatest problem was the flood of February to March 1958, which had a peak flow of 16,000 cubic metres per second and a flood height 3 metres above the previous level. And that was estimated a 1 in 1,000 year event. And you probably wouldn't read too much about a major construction that had a 1 in 100 one year and a 1 in 1,000 event the following year. So the main cofferdam was flooded, the road and footbridge were swept away, the access roads were scoured, 3 access tunnels were closed during the flood. But again, luckily there was no damage to the permanent works, and a revised and accelerated program was prepared and contractual agreements negotiated, which no doubt entailed that the contractor got a lot more money. He does not do it. And the project was back on schedule by the end of 1958. So there's a picture of the 58 flood overtopping the main cofferdam, and that picture doesn't do it justice. When we look at the video, you'll get a better picture of just how scary and how big that flood was. Workforce. There were 8,500 men at the peak of construction, 7,000 Africans and 1,500 Europeans. A lot of those Europeans were Italians, associated with the Italian construction company who was awarded the job. 86 men lost their lives during construction. That's a very high amount and very sad.
including 18 who fell into the concrete and 4 who are still sealed in the arched wall. So if you remember, I was walking down one of those galleries, and it was those 4 fellows that I was sort of thinking about a little bit. So those fallen are commemorated in St. Barbara Church, which is built on the hill above Kariba, lovely circular church. And interestingly, there was no work on Sundays, and all the workers were treated to a lunch in a huge shed. So there's St. Barbara Church, and I guess a lot of the workers would have gone there on Sunday for Mass, being Italians, so they would have been good Catholics. Now here's a scary picture, and probably one of the reasons why a few people died. That's looking up from one of the temporary openings towards the northern part of the wall, and you're looking up at the top of the wall there, and the men are scaling a pretty scary looking ladder, vertical ladder, no harnesses, no lanyards or anything, and occasionally you get a rickety looking platform to change onto another ladder which carries you higher up. So a lot of the access was like that, with relatively small platforms. And one of the major sad events was that one of those walkway or gangways collapsed, and several people drowned in that particular one. So dangerous working conditions. Materials. There's some big numbers here. 600,000 tonnes of granite were blasted from a quarry 2 miles from the site. There were 3 grades of rock. And the coarse aggregate had a maximum size of 200 millimetres. So those older buggers amongst us will remember that those are called plums, or that's what we called them when I learned about that at uni. Today, modern concrete, well, certainly the concrete we generally use around Mackay, has a maximum size of 20 millimetres. So 200, you know, that's a very different sort of a concept with the concrete. There were 3 grades of sand, which was obtained from the San Yodi Gorge just upstream. On the south bank, interestingly, it was hauled 6 miles to a washing and screening plant, and thence by aerial cableway across the gorge to the concrete batching plant on the left bank. Well, the left bank is northern bank as well. There was 322,000 tonnes of cement. The on-site storage comprised 80 silos, totaling 28,000 tonnes. And the cement was transported 103 miles from Chilanga near Lusaka. On the project, 17 million gallons of petrol oil and lubricants was used, and the total weight of all transported materials was 700,000 tonnes. So the concrete rate, they initially started at a rate of 60,000 cubic metres per month. And after the acceleration phase, after the 58 flood, that increased to 100,000 cubic metres per month. My mind just blows at the sort of volume and how quickly and how well coordinated they would have to have been to pull that amount of concrete. And almost all of it was transported in 6 cubic metre skips, and we spoke earlier about the Blondin cable crane, it went from a batching plant in a truck, loaded into the skip, and the skip was transported by cable and then down to its to where the pour was on that particular occasion. The dam is essentially unreinforced, and it was placed in blocks the full dam width on radial joints about 15 metres apart. So if you can visualise the curve of the dam, the blocks were placed constructed around that curve, and each pour was the full width. So the pours were varied in width from the 40 to 24 metres of the dam width. Now, with when you're pouring very large volumes of concrete, you get the heat of hydration. So what they did was they cooled the concrete with refrigerated water, and that was done by putting pipe grids on top of each pour. So each pour was 2.25 metres thick, actually 7 foot 6, but I thought some of you young people might not understand feet and inches, so I had to convert it. So that's a big block of concrete. If you're looking at, say, 20 metres by 15 metres by 2.25 metres. It's probably bigger than this room.
And after cooling, after 5 days after the pour, the temperature, copper temperature was 54 degrees C, and after about 40 to 50 days, that reduced down to 16 to 21 degrees C. So there's a one of the skips that's been lowered down to one of the blocks, and the blocks didn't all rise uniformly. Some were destructed faster, so all sorts of hazards, I think, associated with that. You can see that there's not a lot of handrails around the top of that block, and they're pretty high there. They're above the level of the road bridge. So again, dangerous working conditions, and some of the causes of death were people falling from heights. So there's a bit of a view of the blocks coming up in different stages. That's probably about 75% complete. You can still see the main cofferdam down the bottom. You can see the Blondin carriages up here. So there's two Blondin carriages there on that rail. They're quite big things, and that's the part of the sand aerial cableway that goes across the river to the other side. And that's just another view from the other bank of a similar stage. If you, it's a bit hard to see, but over here is one of those gangway access ways, and it looks pretty flimsy to me. And there's another shot with the Blondin trolley on its cable, with the skip hanging down below and probably being lowered at that stage now. There are the four temporary openings that were left open until after the flood season of 58. Concrete Strength. Now, I was having a chat with a couple of people earlier, and I don't know if there's any concrete boffins here, but the cement content was in the hearting, which that was the wording in this paper. I'm taking hearting to mean the inner part of the wall. The cement content was initially 225 kilos a cube, reducing to about 213 kilos a cube. And the upstream face, which was 3 meters wide, the initial cement content was 285, reducing to 273 kilos a cubic meter. So perhaps the concrete guys could have a bit of a think of the concrete strength. I've estimated it between about 15 and 20 MPa, based purely on cement content, but the size of the plums may have also meant that there was actually more cement for the finer aggregate. So I'm not going to ask any questions now, but have a think about it, we'll talk about it later. All of the radial joints were grouted. So when I was looking at this room, this is not probably not quite the angle, but this would be similar to how the blocks were constructed. Each of those radial joints, where it butted up against the next pour, would be grouted, and they had a significant grouting pump station. The foundations were also grouted to a minimum depth of 25 metres and up to 36 metres below foundation depth. The paper says that there was surprisingly little grout used, which would indicate that the bedrock was very sound and not too many cracks. And there was also a system of pressure relieving holes, 100 millimeter diameter and 45 meters deep immediately downstream of the dam. So that was, I guess, to try and keep the bedrock intact and not induce any other extraneous pressures on it. So there's a picture. There's still a bit of water coming out the temporary opening, but largely the dam is complete and it has started filling. During construction, they did continually release a bit of water to feed the downstream people and wild animals and other things. Obviously, there's still a fair length of the river downstream. Now, interestingly, the dam is located at the southern end of the Great African Great Rift Valley, which is tectonically active. That means there's a bit of plate movement. Now, that wasn't even considered during the design stage. But following the initial filling, there were quite a few earthquakes in the 60s, and some earthquakes are measurable at 5 on the Richter scale. As I mentioned earlier, major inspections are carried out every 5 years, and talking to one fellow countryman, he reckons that the dam has actually shifted about 300 mil downstream since construction, and I haven't actually heard that. So, and it's all moved together apparently, not the same both sides, and it's all good. Now, the Automobile Association put out a little map to help people find their way, and this gives you an idea of the scale of the town. There's the dam wall there, with the switching station. We have Camp Hill, which I imagine was where the first people camped when they were setting up things initially. There's a major township which was built for the African staff, and then the European staff were housed higher up, about 500 metres above the level of the river. So the main purpose of the dam was hydroelectric. There are 6 vertical penstocks, about 100 metres high and varying from 9 to 14 metres diameter. There was two low-level intakes were initially constructed so the power could be generated after one season's of pounding as the dam was filling up. Sector gates are included to control the intakes, and they can close in 20 seconds in case of emergency. There's 3 tail race tunnels, 300 metres long and 28 square metres in section. And 2 generator sets are connected to a single tail race tunnel, so there are 6 gen sets altogether, and each of them, two at a time, go to the tail race. And the tail race is where the water departs after it's turned the turbine. There are 6 turbo generators of the vertical shaft Francis type, each having an output of 100 megawatts. And the generated voltage of 18 kV is stepped up to 330 kV for transmission by means of single phase transformers. Perhaps some of the electrical guys could decipher that for me, because it's a bit complicated. Rich? That's all right. The total length of transmission lines at that time of construction was 1,400 kilometres, and there were 3,264 steel towers. The firm water flow for power was 1,200 cubes a second, so they worked out over the total volume coming down the river how much could be used to generate electricity. The second stage, which I haven't said too much about, was to construct a power station on the north bank, and that has to my understanding, has a similar flow. So the total flow now is about 2,400 cubes a second. So this is how the water comes in. You have, well, that's the top of the dam there. The top water level is just below that. The intake shaft is initially horizontal, and then the penstock is vertical. That goes down to the turbine, and then the water goes out through the tail race. And there's a very large surge chamber. For those of you hydraulic engineers, water is incompressible, and you need to have a large air chamber to absorb any energy if anything happens suddenly with the water. That's the main machine hall. That's the transformer hall, so it's stepped up to 330 underground, and then the 330 comes up to the switching station and distributes out from there. And that's just a bit of a cross-section of the laundry carriage. During construction, they were taken away after it was complete. So that's a slightly more detailed view of that setup. You can see the sector gate there. Looks like it works on a bit of a radial principle. This is the initial low-level intake, which was blocked off once the level rose up to the high-level intake. Cross-section through the machine hall itself. So the water comes in from the penstock, drives the turbine out through the draft tube and to the tail race. Above the turbine is the generator. And in the machine hall is There are two 200-ton cranes to help maintain the generators. They quite often, during that little walk around I had when I was in the army, there was a spare turbine sitting there, and there were some wear marks on the vanes, and they regularly have to turn out the turbines and repair those that are wear, because otherwise it would wear right through. And the vanes were about 25 millimetres thick, so quite a big thing. So that's a plan view, or from the looking down from the top of the underground. The underground stuff is all dotted. So we've got the six generators along here. We've got penstocks which go down there. Once they go through the turbine, they're out. Those three big circles are the surge chambers, and then out through the tail race. So the first tail race, which way you look at it, was incorporated into the diversion tunnel. If you remember, in stage one there was a diversion tunnel, and that was plugged just upstream of the dam wall at a particular stage. And that's the switching station, quite a big switching station, which sends the power out. Costs. So in 1956 they estimated it was going to cost around £80 million. It was funded by a loan from the World Bank. The mining companies were very keen to get power, so they put some money in, a couple of banks, Barclays and Standard Banks, which are major banks in Africa, and the Commonwealth Development Corporation. And the final cost was 79.61, which in today's value is about 2.5 billion Australian. So I reckon that's quite a cheap project if you think that the Gateway expansion recently was about a billion. So it's about 2.5 of those. I'm just trying to put it in perspective, you know, whether it's in today's money, if it's a cheap project. I don't think you could get that project today for $2.5 million. So power generation, we've spoken a bit about that. 600 megawatts on the South Bank. North Station, when it was completed, it was 614. The North Station has since been upgraded to 1,080, and the South will be, if it hasn't already started, it's about to start, upgrade to 1050. Annual power generation is 6,400 gigawatt hours, and the original rotors weighed 380 tonnes. Now, part of the logistics of building the dam was that everything was imported. There was no facilities in Africa at that time to build generators and rotors of that size. So the rotors were made, I think, in England, because that was one of the electric companies. And that would have gone by ship to Beira, which is a town on the east coast of Mozambique, and thence by road up to Kariba. So they were constrained by bridge sizes, bridge widths, and other things like that. The size of the maximum size of the rotors and the generator that they could take up. So that's a bit of a picture inside the machine hall. Very, very shiny and clean. The generators are in these hexagonal shaped things. So there are six. This is the South Power Station. And that's another shot looking down from the top of the machine hall. That's a bit hard to see, but that's during construction in the machine hall. The number one stator is ready for its rotor. And that's a bit of a better picture. You can see the big crane at the top, the 200-ton gantry crane. For those of you who possibly don't know about generators, there are two major parts. The stator, which is the big part on the outside, which stays still. That's why it's called a stator, because it's static. And then there's the middle part, the inside part, called the rotor, which rotates. Quite simplistic, these electrical terms that come up, eh? Thousands of transmission towers, taking 330 kV across the countries. completion took 6 years of total construction, so that was the wall and the hydroelectric, so that one man could throw a switch to start 100 dials to produce 600 megawatts of 330 kV electrical power. Just a little bit more to speak before we go to the DVD. Ecological. There were 57,000 native Wimbi Tonga people living in the footprint of the lake. They lived a tribal life, planting two crops per year in the fertile floodplains, tending herds of small cattle, sheep and goats. Now, they were all relocated to higher ground and provided with houses similar to their tradition, provided with farmland and new crops and fruits. But it remains to this day as probably one of the world's greatest ecological disasters, because those people are effectively displaced, and they I don't believe, from what I've read, they have never regained the culture and the traditions that they had in their floodplain life. The southern Tonga have largely been absorbed into the surrounding culture, that's in Zimbabwe. The northern Tonga remains strong but suffer from displacement of their traditional lands. Now, the Tonga people had a river god called Nyami Nyami. And there was at the upstream end of the gorge was a big rock in the river. They reckoned that Nyami Nyami lives in that rock, and he was a very important god of theirs. And he was sort of a part fish and part serpent, kind of a thing that they believed lived in the river. And they didn't think that he would let the people dam the river, and they believed that Nyami Nyami sent the big floods down during construction. And they also today believe that the earthquakes come from Nyami Nyami, who's looking for his wife, who's downstream. And every time he swims into the wall, he makes it shake. So that's a typical sort of a house of the Tonga people. And I reckon the stilts are there because a lot of their lands would have been flooded from time to time, depending on the size of the flood, so they built them high to keep dry. Environmental. So I mentioned that flows were continued during construction to feed the downstream part of the river. But obviously as the impoundment grew, significant upstream areas became flooded. As the waters rose, animals became trapped on islands, which then didn't become islands anymore as the waters rose higher. So Operation Noah, it took place from 1958 to 64, and they rescued 6,000 large and many other smaller animals. And Rupert Fothergill was the spearhead of that operation. He was with the Southern Rhodesia National Parks, and he kind of coordinated the rescue efforts. Long-term downstream effects include lack of flooding and replenishment of alluvial soils in the downstream floodplains. And that includes areas of national park that animals live in. It includes areas further downstream where there may have been people living in a floodplain area. So it affects humans, animals and flora. By the same token, there's less flooding downstream, so people have moved into areas that were previously very flood prone. And they have to send out very timely warnings if they open the floodgates, because they're right on the banks of what today is a reasonably small river. And when they open, particularly when they open six floodgates, they need to advise. And of course, there's different countries downstream, so there's a bit of a process to get that advice through. And they're not all on the telephone either, so that makes it a bit difficult. So that's just a bit of a shot of a couple of animals being transported in a boat across to the mainland. Tourism is a major thing that grew from the lake. It wasn't considered during the planning period, but it has contributed to significant businesses, hotels, houseboats, recreational fishing, tiger fish, for example, water sport activities, game viewing, a number among the tourist pursuits. So that's the sort of thing you can do while you're fishing for your bream or your tiger fish of an evening, sipping a beer at Kariba. Present day, Northern Power Station was developed in 1977, sometime after it was originally planned. The Northern Southern Power Stations have been upgraded, or are being upgraded, as I mentioned.
There is concern about the dam stability, including downstream scour. The plunge pool where the jet of water ends up is some 80 metres deep, and that's scoured from the original bedrock. If you remember the original cross-section, that showed the bedrock was fairly flat from the base of the dam. Some remedial works are planned, and there's a multi-beam bathymetric photo which shows the current situation, and we'll get to it shortly. So there's the dam with, I believe, 6 floodgates open at that time, significant amount of water, and significant turbulence down at the bottom where it hits the river. Notwithstanding, there's a big pool of water, so the water itself absorbs some of the energy, but in that, there's a lot of turbulence, which has created, before I get to that crossing, just a few shots of the dam as it is today. You can see the curvature, the vertical curvature as well as the horizontal curvature quite well in that photo. So there's the plunge pool today. It's about 80 metres below original bed level, and there is some maintenance works planned here, I understand, and they're also planning to possibly mine and excavate downstream so that the water doesn't create a backflow or a backdraft. You'll be able to get away a little bit easier. And that's the bathymetric photo that I was talking about, which gave them a profile of the actual shape of the hole. It's obviously not very regular. And they've taken that into a lab, and they've modelled that. So underneath the water, they've got that shape of the plunge pool, and they've got strain gauges along the edges, and they're going to test the different shapes if they excavate to see what the best shape is to reduce the stresses and turbulence. Of course, there are quite significant constraints, because here in the model are the tail race outfalls. So they're quite close in, and obviously the stability of those needs to remain intact. So they can slightly widen the plunge pool, but the main option is to extend it downstream. All right, so before we get to the DVD, I'd just like to make a couple of acknowledgements. My daughter said that if you ever give a paper, you should acknowledge where you got your stuff from, so I'd like to acknowledge the internet. The photos that I found that had copyright on them, but they're freely available on the internet. And particularly paper 6479 of the Institution of Engineers. And if you want to do some further reading and find out more detail, that has a good bit of detail in it. So let's go to the DVD. It's compiled from 16 and 8mm film. The film was old when they converted it to DVD, so some of the sound and picture is a little bit crabby, but I think we'll see how we go. All right, there is some more video after that, but it is a very, very dry presenter, and it is getting late. So we might pull it up there. We'll just open up to questions, if anybody's got any questions, and then we can turn it back on if anybody is interested. So anything?
Yeah, Bruce. Do you know why they built the diversion tunnel, given that the first stage had the blocks out?
I haven't found any factual stuff. I imagine it was additional capacity to let the water through. Is any concrete guy come up with the concrete strength answer? Roy, got any ideas?
No, not really, not with that aggregate. You'd really have to go through and sort of work out what's going on. Thing is, with aggregate that size, you're basically talking about the strength of the aggregate. It's really all the mortar's doing is holding it together and mobilising the aggregate more than the, say, 20 mil or 10 mil. So The system they used is very, very similar to that used in Warragamba Dam in Sydney, which is where I did see some of that, and they did have the big Telfer crane, the big cranes and everything else that they used in that construction. Very, very similar in construction, and they had the suspension bridge and you know, whether they used that as an example, but that was built in the sort of, that sort of, I suppose it would have been late 50s, 60s period in New South Wales as well.
Okay. Anything else? All right, well, thank you very much for your attention, and for those who wish to stay, we can turn the video back on, but quick, thank you.
Return the pens.
We're on a budget.
There we are.